This is a picture of infective endocarditis. As I said, this is an opened heart, and this is the aorta, and this is the aortic valve cusp. As you can see, this large masses which are called vegetations. Now, those vegetations are seen in cases of infective endocarditis. Infective endocarditis can be can happen in an acute fashion when we have a virulent microorganism such as Staph aureus, and it can occur in a subacute fashion when it is when we have less virulent microorganisms such as Strep viridans. We have significant risk factors for infective endocarditis. We want to talk about them in this lab. Now, here we have a closer look at the cusps. شوفوا كيف الكسبس of the valve are destructed and invaded by those vegetations. So this will lead to serious valvular destruction. Now, those irregular reddish tan vegetations overlie the valve cusps that are being destroyed. Portion of the vegetations can break off and become septic emboli. ذول الفيجيتيشنز بالعادة بيكونوا فريابل. They are easy detachable, يعني part of it can detach and go through the bloodstream and cause embolization to another area. We call them septic emboli because they are composed of bacteria and other parts of the vegetation زي ما راح نشوف. Now this is another case of infective endocarditis at which the vegetations and the infection is extending from the valve cusps into the ash into the adjacent endocardium causing ash endocarditis اللي هو النيم. Now here we have vegetations extend into the endocardial surface and the infection is also extending to the underlying myocardium in cases or in severe cases. The infection can dig also deep in the wall of the heart reaching the myocardium. Sometimes when we have acute severe infection and significant damage, the wall of the heart can be damaged totally at the area of infection and this result in this appearance اللي هي الفيستولا formation. Fistula هون is an abnormal connection between two surfaces. فهون في عندنا احنا left ventricle وهون عندنا right ventricle على الطرف الثاني. هون في عندنا ايش fistula in the interventricular septum which is an abnormal finding which can result in murmur and damage to the heart. Now after damage of the cusp of the valve, شوفوا كيف هون الvalvular cusps, they are damaged and we have fenestrations. في عندنا small fenestration وفي عندنا large fenestration. Function of the aortic valve is to close after the blood is ejected from the left ventricle to prevent the blood flow back from the aorta into the left ventricle simply. Now when we have those fenestrations, the blood will flow back and in a very high pressure into the left ventricle. This will result into the damage to the underlying endocardium. This is called jet lesion. This result to damage to the endocardium and endocardial fibrosis. The blood لما برجع من الأورطة through those fenestration in a very high pressure it will damage the endocardium result in this appearance. Now what can we do for a damaged valve? We can do valvular replacement or prosthesis. Now that we can replace the valve with a biovalve خلينا نحكي من another animal or it can be synthetic. هون في عندنا الفالف شوفوا كيف and it is sutured at its place. But unfortunately, this valve gets infected, secondarily infected. And this is one of the complications of valvular replacement. Horn, the valve, as we said, become infected with the large vegetations filling the valve orifice. And this is one complication of valve prosthesis. Histologically, the vegetations اللي شفناهم قبل شوي, they looks like this. And they are composed of two areas. Blue areas, dark blue areas, and pinkish areas. Dark blue areas, they are composed of bacterial colonies along with acute inflammatory cells. بينما the pink areas, they are composed of fibrin and platelets. Fibrin and platelets. زي ما انتم شايفين كيف شكلهم, they are friable. ممكن مثلا هذا البارت ينفصل, detach and go through the bloodstream resulting in septic emboli. This is another picture. This is the valve and this is the stroma, the connective tissue stroma of the valve that is infiltrated by those vegetations. So now cardiac valves are relatively avascular. The blood supply of the valves is very limited. So we need to give usually high doses of antibiotic therapy to eradicate the infection. كمان duration of the treatment بتكون أطول من الانفكشن العادي. Why? We give high doses and we give longer duration لأنه إحنا بدنا higher bioavailability. لا ايش الانتيبيوتيك كمية البلد اللي بتصل للفالف is very limited فبالتالي we increase the dose as we can in order to ايش to eradicate the infection. Other extra cardiac signs that can be seen in patients with infective endocarditis is something like this, which is called splinter hemorrhage. Splinter hemorrhage, they are subangual. Subangual means under the nail. Linear dark red streaks. Now, this appearance or this hemorrhage is not specific for infective endocarditis. Anyone can get splinter hemorrhage when his nail, يعني لما يصح له تروما على النيل ممكن يصير عنده هذا المنظر. ولكن in other patients with other symptoms, it can be a feature of infective endocarditis. This is another splinter hemorrhage. And this patient has undergone blood culture, and it comes back positive for Staph aureus, which means he has an infective endocarditis. Now, another type of endocarditis is called non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis or Marantic endocarditis. Now, this type of endocarditis occurs in patients who are hypercoagulable. They have hypercoagulable status. عندهم increased tendency to coagulation. زي مثلا الناس اللي عندهم إشي اسمه تروزيه syndrome, which is a paraneoplastic syndrome seen in different types of cancers. واحد منهم pancreatic cancer. بكون عندهم increased coagulation. فهذولا السمول اللي انتم شايفينهم vegetations بيختلفوا عن ال vegetations اللي شفناهم في حالات ال infective endocarditis. They are much smaller, but still they are prone to embolization. They can detach part of them and embolize to another area. It can also occur in severely ill persons. On another picture for Marantic endocarditis, Marantic vegetations. As we said, they are usually small. They are rarely over 0.5 centimeter in size. However, they are friable and have the capability to embolize. هاي هون الهيستولوجي شوفوا كلهم عبارة عن pink. ليش pink؟ لأنه فيهم بس fibrin and platelets. ما في عندنا بكتيريا. اسمهم أصلاً إيش؟ non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis. فبالتالي ما في عندي هون بكتيريا ولا في عندي inflammation. بحكي لك إنه الفاريشن تاعهم is like brown paper bag. زي كيس الورق هيك شكلهم مرات بكونوا طعوجين. Okay? Such bland vegetations are typical of non-infective forms of endocarditis. Another form of endocarditis is called Lippmann-Sachs endocarditis. And Lippmann-Sachs endocarditis, this specific type is seen in patients with systemic lupus erythematosus, SLE. كلياتنا بنعرف شو هو SLE. Now, those vegetations, أيهم, they are erythematous and spreading over the line of closure of the valves, and it can also spread ash into the cordy tendon. But these vegetations only appear in 4% of patients with SLE, and they rarely cause a problem because they are not large and rarely embolize. فبالتالي صفعت عندنا الانفكتيف بيكونوا large and they embolize, المارانتيك they are small but still have the capability of embolization, وعندنا هذول اللي Lippmann-Sachs بيكونوا small and they do not embolize. We have thickened, shortened and diffused cordy tendon here, and this is not due to Lippmann-Sachs endocarditis. This is usually due to rheumatic heart disease. شوفوا هون another type of vegetations. They are called verrucous vegetations. Verrucous اللي هي warty, زي الثواليل باللغة العربية. They are small warty vegetations seen on the line of closure of the mitral valve. This appearance of those warty vegetations is specific for rheumatic carditis or acute rheumatic heart disease. Okay? Now, those vegetations are only a few millimeter in size, and such verruci are too small to cause serious cardiac problems. فبالتالي rheumatic heart disease المشكلة مش في الacute stage, المشكلة في recurrent attacks. لأنه this is an immunologically mediated disease. مزبوط شو اللي بيصير؟ بكون في عندنا infection by group A beta hemolytic strip. الجسم بيطلع antibodies against the bacteria, and those antibodies can cross react with antigens in the heart. فبالتالي الانتيبوديز والاتاك ايش بارت اوف ذا هارت سبيشلي المايترال فال زي ما راح نشوف كمان شوي. اوكي, يصير في عندي انفلاميشن فيجيتيشنز, بعدين يصير في عندي هيلينج, برجع بصير انفلاميشن مره ثانيه, بعد فتره برجع بصير هيلينج. This circle of inflammation and healing, damage and healing will result in ايش, in severe damage and deformation of the cardiac valves اللي هم involved by the rheumatic heart disease. فواحدة من الأبيرانس اللي منشوفها اللي هو this appearance. This is called fish mouth deformity. Fish mouth deformity of the mitral valve. And this is results from chronic rheumatic scarring. زي ما حكيت لكم بكون في عندي inflammation, برجع بصير healing, برجع بصير inflammation, وهكذا. This will result in the scarring of the mitral valve. Now, the mitral valve is the most common to be affected by rheumatic heart disease. After it, the mitral and aortic together. After that, إنه الأورتيك alone. After that, mitral, aortic, and tricuspid valves together. بالتالي لازم نتذكر هذا الترتيب. Mitral, mitral aortic, then aortic alone, then mitral, aortic, and tricuspid. Rheumatic heart disease is an immunologically mediated disease called, as we said, following group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection. Now, let's talk about another condition which is called pericarditis. Now, anatomically, you know that the heart is covered by the pericardium from the outside. Pericardium is composed of two layers, the visceral pericardium, which lines the epicardial surface, and we have the parietal pericardium, okay, which is and in between them, we have the pericardial cavity or the pericardial sac, which contains only a thin rim of fluid. And the pericardium, بالعادة, is an elastic bag, let's say, that contains the heart, and it moves as the heart move. يعني هي بتتحرك مع حركة الهارت. وبيكون في عندنا outer layer اللي هو fibrous pericardium, مش رح نحكي عنه هلا. Now, one of the types of pericarditis اللي هي بنسميها احنا serous pericarditis. And in serous pericarditis, simply we have accumulation of serous fluid in the pericardial sac with minimal inflammation. With minimal inflammation. شوفوا هون كلها عبارة عن yellowish fluid and we have those scattered dots اللي هم عبارة عن inflammatory cells. Okay? So serous pericarditis is marked by fluid collection. Rarely fluid collection may be large enough to cause tamponade. شو tamponade؟ زي ما حكيت لكم أو زي ما حكينا إنه في عندنا fluid around the heart. هلا إذا كانت الفلويد هذا كميته كبيرة شو راح تعمل؟ راح تعمل restriction على الهارت موشن اللي هي الفيلينج لما بصير refilling والpumping. لما يكون compressed by this fluid, this will result in in pericardial tamponade. Tamponade اللي هي something from outside compressing the heart and prevent it from doing its normal function. تالي بيجي البيشنت بالترياد اللي هو weak pulse, بيجي بمفلد heart sound, هاي اللي هي أشياء clinical. Okay? Now, the second type of pericarditis اللي هو fibrinous pericarditis. Simply from its name, we have بيكون في عندنا يعني secretion أو خلينا نحكي deposition of fibrin within within the pericardium. هذول الred squiggly lines هم عبارة عن fibrin deposition. Now, fibrinous pericarditis is seen in patients with uremia and renal failure. Uremia اللي هي very high level of urea اللي هي related للrenal failure in patient with underlying myocardial infarction and in patient with acute rheumatic carditis. Those are the main causes of fibrinous pericarditis. Now, this is an opened pericardial window. شوفوا كيف في عندي هذول threads. Those threads are fibrinous material that has been organized into this appearance. Normally, أو بعض الأحيان معظم الأحيان fibrin will be will be resorbed back there by the the inflammatory cells, the neutrophils والmacrophages راح ينظفوا هاي المنطقة. بس أحيانا part of the fibrin will remain and will be organized into this appearance forming those threads. As we said, there are thin strands of fibrinous exudate that extend from the epicardial surface to the pericardial sac. And this is typical for fibrinous pericarditis. Another gross appearance for fibrinous pericarditis. شوفوا كيف surface of the heart أو pericardium is shaggy and irregular. هيك surface is irregular and this is due to fibrin deposition. Okay? Normally the surface of the heart must be glistening and smooth. هيك بيكون very smooth and glistening. بينما هون is irregular and shaggy. And we have strands of thin fibrin covering the heart. This is another appearance هون هاي بنسميها احنا bread and butter appearance اللي هو للفيبرينس بريكارديتس في عندنا exudation of fibrin هاي اللي هي الماتيريال اللي بيحكوا عنها زي البتر يعني وهاي الاندرلاينج اللي هو البريد okay now the fibrin often results in the finding on physical examination of a friction rub احنا بالمستشفى لما بيجينا المريض مش رايحين نفتح صدره ونطلع على الهارت نشوف فيه فيبرين ولا ما فيش فيبرين we auscultate the heart so we hear something called friction rub Friction rub, اللي هو the sound you hear when the patient is having pericarditis, and it is like the sound when you take two leathery surfaces and cause them to frick together. بنسميها إحنا friction rub. تمسك two leathery surfaces, شغلتين من الجلد وتحكهم مع بعض بيطلع عندك صوت. هذا بنسميه the friction rub. which we auscultate in patient with ايش؟ with pericarditis. شوفوا هون كيف عندي histology. This is the epicardial surface and those هاي الاريز اللي هم عبارة عن fibrin. فبالتالي this is وهون we have inflammatory cells in the ايش؟ in the epicardial surface. So this is the histological appearance of fibrinous pericarditis. As I said, eventually the fibrin can be organized and cleared, though sometimes adhesions may remain. And when we remove the predisposing condition, the inflammatory system will take care of the fibrin, remove it, and everything can come back to normal. But sometimes part of the fibrin will remain and cause the formation of those threads. Now, this is another pattern of pericarditis, which is called hemorrhagic pericarditis. Now, in hemorrhagic pericarditis, simply it is a special type of fibrinous pericarditis. في عندنا fibrinous pericarditis, which is ايش overlaid by hemorrhage. صار في عندنا hemorrhage مع fibrinous pericarditis. Hemorrhagic pericarditis is different from hemopericardium. Hemopericardium means the accumulation of blood without inflammation in the pericardial sac. هاي بنسميها hemopericardium. حتى ال causes بتختلف. الهيموبيريكارديوم بالعادة is related to trauma. يكون في عندي تروما أو دمج معين أدى لإيش؟ للهيموبيريكارديوم. بينما الهيموراجيك بيريكارديتس is usually seen in different causes. This is another gross appearance of hemorrhagic pericarditis. شوفوا كيف the surface is reddish and irregular لأنه زي ما حكينا this is a part of fibrinous pericarditis أو special type of fibrinous pericarditis. Hemorrhagic pericarditis is especially seen in metastatic tumor. لما يكون في عندي malignancy metastasizing into the heart and also in cases of tuberculosis. Now tuberculosis is rarely affect the heart and rarely cause hemorrhagic pericarditis. As you all know, mycobacterium tuberculosis شو type of inflammation اللي بتعمل اياه؟ بتعمل لي granulomatous inflammation صح؟ بتعمل لي granulomas. Now this granulomatous inflammation can result in a different pattern رح نحكي عنه اللي هو constrictive pericarditis. Another type of pericarditis هو purulent pericarditis. Purulent pericarditis is simply infection. في عنا bacteria. Bacteria is involving the pericardium. And as you can notice here, we have pus exudation within the pericardium. Usually the cause of a purulent pericarditis in very severely ill patient, واحد عنده severe pneumonia, the infection can spread from the lungs into the ash, into the heart. Or it can spread also by hematogenous spread in septicemic patients, الناس اللي عندهم septicemia. This is what is called constrictive pericarditis. Constrictive pericarditis is not common and it is usually caused by mycobacterium tuberculosis. Now as we said, في عندنا granulomatous inflammation. This granulomatous inflammation can cause calcification of the pericardium. Now when we have calcification of the pericardium, شو اللي راح يصير؟ راح يصير the pericardium, it will lose his elasticity, صح؟ راح it will lose المرونة تاعيته، فبالتالي it will restrict the heart motion. Okay؟ فايش؟ في عندنا extensive granulomatous inflammation with calcification that can severely restrict cardiac motion. Okay؟ لأنه normally زي ما حكينا ال heart بصير له enlargement during filling بكبر، بعدين شو بصير؟ بعمل pumping، فبالتالي لازم يكون في عندي elastic covering لل heart. Once I have calcification of the pericardium, this will be restricted. هذول الناس بيكون في عندهم impaired filling, بصير في عندهم فيما بعد heart failure, and they need sometimes surgical correction of the problem. Another problem that could affect the heart is the presence of those small micro abscesses at the surface of the heart. هذولا المايكرو abscesses شايفينهم. And this usually occurs when in the patients who have septicemia, اللي هم bacteria in the blood. The bacteria when it is present in the blood, it can travel through the blood to any area and it can settle in any area كمان. فبالتالي those bacterial micro abscesses are due to ايش؟ to infection of the surface of the heart. هاي هون كمان عندي another micro abscess اللي هي على ال epicardial surface. As we said, they appear in persons who are septic and have hematogenous spread of infection. Also, they may also represent emboli from an infective endocarditis through the coronary vessels. قبل شوي شفنا ال vegetations وقلنا ممكن part of them to detach. ممكن يعمل detachment وروح through the coronary arteries. يمشي بالcoronary arteries ويعمل لي ايش؟ microabscess على surface of the heart. The histological appearance of abscess, it is an abscess like any abscess in the body. We have central area of bacterial colony surrounded by acute inflammatory cells. Okay? This is the appearance of abscess. Now, another finding, significant finding that can be seen in patients with rheumatic heart disease or rheumatic carditis اللي هم الأشوف نوديولز. شوفوا هون في عندي الميوكارديوم, هاي الميوكارديال muscles, هاي هون عندي blood vessel, هون في عندي this proliferation or this nodule of cells. Those are called Aschoff nodules and they are seen best in the myocardium. Now, the Aschoff nodules are centered in the interstitium around the vessels and myocarditis may be severe enough to cause congestive heart failure in cases of acute rheumatic carditis. بالتالي غير الأكيوت الروماتيك هارت ديزيز غير انه ممكن يعمل دمج للفالفز ويعمل لي ديفورميتيز كمان ممكن يعمل لي ايش احيانا مايوكارديتس اند هارت فيلير. This is a closer magnification of the Aschoff nodule. شوفوا كيف في عندي مالتي نيوكليتد سيلز هم اصلا عباره عن هيستيوسايتس ماكروفاجز and sometimes they fuse together to form what is called Aschoff giant cells which are the most characteristic cells. Several appear here as large cells with two or more nuclei that have prominent nucleoli and we have also scattered inflammatory cells accompanying them which can be mononuclear or occasionally sometimes we have neutrophils. Other cells that can give us a hint that this is a rheumatic heart disease is the presence of this Antishkao myocyte. شوفوا كيف هاي large myocyte. Myocyte means muscle cell. It's different from its neighbors. It is elongated, thin, and they have also elongated nucleus. This is called Antishkao myocyte. As I said earlier, rheumatic heart disease can cause damage and scarring of the heart valves. On we have scarred mitral valve, and we have also shortened and thickened and damaged cordy tendon. فبالتالي this is a chronic rheumatic valvulitis, which result in severe damage of the mitral valve. And as you can notice, we have shortened and thickened cordy tendon. Another problem that could affect the heart is myocarditis. Here you can notice the myocardium is infiltrated by a mixed inflammatory cells that is composed of mononuclear cells, اللي هم lymphocytes, but we can also have plasma cells, macrophages, and also acute inflammatory cells such as neutrophils. Now, this pattern of mixed inflammation is usually seen in patients with toxoplasmic myocarditis, infection by Toxoplasma gondii. And Toxoplasma gondii can be seen within the myocardium as this appearance. This is called pseudocyst. And this pseudocyst contains bradyzoite. Such an infection is typical for immunocompromised hosts. فبالتالي toxoplasmosis do not affect immunocompetent people. It affects persons with immunosuppression, such as patients with AIDS. The most common cause of myocarditis is viral myocarditis. As you can notice here, the myocardium is infiltrated by lymphocytes mainly, or only, خلينا نحكي. And this is the typical appearance of viral myocarditis, which is probably the most common type of myocarditis. Now, many of these cases can be subclinical. شو يعني subclinical? يعني they occur and they are cleared without any damage. بيجي patient حتى ممكن ما يصير عنده أي symptoms بدون ما يحس. But المشكلة إنه viral myocarditis أحيانا it can be lethal. ممكن patient يصير عنده sudden death بسبب viral myocarditis. Now, the most common cause for viral myocarditis is Coxsackie B virus. في عندنا other viruses that can result in viral myocarditis, بس كمان Coxsackie B هو the most common. Now, the final topic to talk about is اللي هم cardiomyopathies. Now, as you can see here, the heart is abnormal. It is dilated. We have dilatation of the four chambers, both atria and both ventricles. And the heart here is very flappy. Flappy يعني very relaxed, رخو هيك, spongy, okay? هاي معنى flappy. And it is very poorly contractile. It is large, huge, and it is thick, but it is very poorly contractile. This is called dilated cardiomyopathy. Dilated cardiomyopathy. And there is no specific histologic findings. هاي, this is a clinical diagnosis. شوفوا كيف هنا, it is opened, and you can notice how dilatation of the ventricular chamber. Many of these cases have no known etiology. They are called idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy, while others can be associated with chronic alcoholism or with inherited genetic mutations. The heart, as we said, is grossly enlarged and flappy. Histologically, you can notice hypertrophied muscular fibers along with interstitial fibrosis in between them. And this fibrosis is abnormal. Usually in the myocardium, we see only cardiac muscle cells only. Any abnormal material can result in severe damage to the heart and cardiomyopathy. Okay? فبالتالي هون في عندنا fibrosis and also hypertrophy of the myocardial fibers. Second type of cardiomyopathy is called hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Now in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy we have asymmetric bulging هون شوفوا كيف في الانترفنتريكولار سيبتم. هاي الانترفنتريكولار سيبتم نورمالي الثيكنس تاعه المفروض يكون بس هالقد، اوكي؟ okay? بينما شوفوا هون قديش في عندي انكريز بالثيكنس. Now hypertrophic cardiomyopathy half of these cases are familial though a variety of different genes may be responsible for this disease. Both children and adults can be affected and many of them sudden death بيجو ايش sudden death. And here we have the explanted heart. Heart patient عنده hypertrophic cardiomyopathy اجى مثلا بمالتيبل سينكوبال اتاك صار عنده ايش سينكوبي غيب مره مرتين ثلاث بعدين عملنا له ايكو شفنا انه في عنده hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. The only solution for this is heart transplantation. لازم تشيل الهارت تبعه وتحط له another heart. Okay? Now, what is the problem in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? And this can result in ايش؟ In occlusion of the lumen of the right ventricle, left ventricle when it is contract. كمان لما بصير في contraction ممكن ال opening of the aorta تسكر، فالبلد اصلا ما يطلع through the aorta، عشان هيك بصير عندهم syncopal attacks. Histologically, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy demonstrates something called myofiber disarray. شوفوا كيف الفايبرز الكارديك مسل فايبرز they are haphazardly arranged. ما في عندنا ايش normal arrangement and in between also we have collagen deposition. هاي الترايكروم ستين هنا البلوش كلر هذا this is fibrosis. Such abnormal areas اللي هي هاي المناطق اللي فيها الفايبروسيس وفيها الirregular muscle fibers can predispose to cardiac arrhythmias which can be fatal. Now third pattern of cardiomyopathy احنا بنسميه restrictive cardiomyopathy. And simply restrictive cardiomyopathy is due to deposition of abnormal material within the myocardium. فمثلا هون عندنا الهيموكروماتوسيس اللي هو a genetic disease result from a problem in iron metabolism which result in excessive iron concentration in the serum and deposition of iron in different parts of the body. واحدة من المناطق اللي بصير فيها deposition of iron here we have the excessive iron levels within the serum and we have also iron deposition within different parts of the bodies. فهون في عندنا iron is deposited within the ash within the myocardium. This stain is called Prussian blue stain and Prussian blue stain is used to demonstrate the presence of iron. Iron will take the ash the blue color and this will result in enlargement and failure of the heart similar to ash to cardiomyopathy and this is called restrictive cardiomyopathy. Another material that could be deposited within the myocardium is amyloid. بسميها احنا amyloidosis. شوفوا كيف هاي هون عندي cardiac muscle fibers هون in between عندي this pink amorphous material and this is ايش amyloidosis. Now amyloidosis can affect any part of the body وكمان part of them اللي هو ايش الheart. فبالتالي this will result in infiltrative or restrictive cardiomyopathy. Now the presence of amyloid can result as we said earlier in severe intractable arrhythmias that can damage ايش can cause sudden death to the patient. How can we highlight the presence of amyloid? By doing a stain called Congored stain. Now Congored stain will give ايش will give the amyloid an orange red color. باخذ ايش orange red color. How can we be sure that this is an amyloid? We examine the section that is stained by Congored under the polarizing microscope. Under the polarizing microscope. And thus it will give us this ايش apple green perfringence. هاي اللون اللي هو ايش الاخضر دليل على وجود ايش الامايلويد within the myocardium. Okay? يعطيكم العافية.